Here is a story told to the children of Africa.
We love the children of Africa. Teaching the children. Ooh, da, 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 da. La da da da. Oi, black eye, black hair, black skin, black queen, stand majestic with the black king. Today I'll sing you a black song. You need to hear about beautiful black things. Cause most time we hear about black, we hear about black magic and black witches. Blacklist, black book, black market, black Friday, you spend off your black witches. I've never seen a doctor in black, nor seen a black pill to cure no black people. But I've seen bush doctors like Tosh and Molly resurrect like a real black beetle. Malcolm, Marcus, Martin. When you see Walter Rodney, ask him. How you not hear about how we laughing? So when the little offspring asking, tell them. They never told us that black is beautiful. They never told.
Hi, I'm Shukrani Gray, the African American Resource Collection Equity and Inclusion Librarian at the New Orleans Public Library. Welcome to our Martin Luther King Jr. virtual celebration, sponsored by the Louisiana Endowments for Humanities and the Friends of the New Orleans Public Library. Our goal in this program is to honor Dr. King's legacy and all that he was able to accomplish during the Civil Rights era. But we also want to highlight the local community members like you and I whose works made Dr. King's successes possible. We want to show how Dr. King passed the torch for social justice to us today by highlighting artists and activists who have committed to making change in our community. And finally, as you are watching this video, we ask that you reflect to see how you can use your gifts, your talents, and your actions to bring about positive change in your community.
I started a career working for the National Park Service. I felt that it was extremely important in New Orleans, Louisiana, to highlight the culture as well as the history of African diasporic people that have lived here, those that were brought here against their will, and the ones that really made the city world famous and synonymous with so many different aspects of things that we take as everyday lifestyle here in New Orleans. Just to highlight that and have people to understand, for example, that if you go to a place like Congo Square or you hear some music here, that that music was built out of a struggle and that it was not something that people just created for pleasure and fun, but it was means and ways to survive. So I use that platform to help to educate adults as well as young people in ways like creating books and the music that I create myself, perform and write. I always keep my eyes on the prize when it comes to that.
A lot of my work is in that same vein, mainly too about this aspect of ancestral reverence and what that means to honor ancestors through our art. But honoring our ancestors past, present, and future. So past, of course, being the ones who have transitioned and future being those who have yet to come and those little ones that's roaming around. But then the present, how we're honoring ourselves. What does that mean to look at one another, to look at everything and see the wonder of who we are, the divinity of who we are, and the beauty in our blackness. So my poetry is centered in that aspect of work and what that means to truly move as a spiritual activist, and how that, just to even go back in that word, how that activates even more spirit, how that activates even more awareness and culture and consciousness in the world.
If any of you are around when I have to meet my day. I don't want a long funeral. And if you get somebody to deliver the eulogy, tell them not to talk too long. And every now and then I wonder what I want them to say. Tell them not to mention that I have a Nobel Peace Prize. That isn't important. Tell them not to mention that I have 300 or 400 other awards. That's not important. Tell them not to mention where I went to school. I'd like somebody to mention that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to give his life serving others. I'd like for somebody to say that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to love somebody. I want you to say that day that I tried to be right on the war question. I want you to be able to say that day that I did try to feed the hungry. I want you to be able to say that day that I did try in my life to clothe those who were naked. I want you to say on that day that I did try in my life to visit those who were in prison. I want you to say that I tried to love and serve humanity. Yes, if you want to say that I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for justice. Say that I was a drum major for peace. I was a drum major for righteousness, and all of the other shallow things will not matter. I won't have any money to leave behind. I won't have the fine and luxurious things of life to leave behind, but I just want to leave a committed life behind. And that's all I want to say. If I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word of song, if I can show somebody he's traveling wrong, then my living will not be in vain. If I can do my duty as a Christian, or if I can bring salvation to a world once wrought, if I can spread the message as the master taught, then my living will not be in vain. Yes, Jesus, I want to be on your right or your left side, not for any selfish reason. I want to be on your right or your left side, not in terms of some political kingdom or ambition, but I just want to be there in love and in justice and in truth and in commitment to others so that we can make of this old world a new world.
I think that's a heavy question too, because in New Orleans you come up many ways. Catholic is one of them. I'm saying that because I have to use that space of church in this aspect, because it was something that fostered spirit. It also fostered again this aspect of activism for me. When it comes down to this safe and sacred space, right? To be able to do your art, do your work, to be able to dream in that sense, right? And the honor and the bravery that comes with what it means to be just that, a dreamer, what it means to move in hope, and the bravery that comes with hope, hopefulness, gratitude, all of these kind of things that King really stood for, this aspect of beloved community. But, you know, to really move from this space of love, the love of ourselves, the love of our people, the love of God in this way, and what that means to bring that forward in our art. I think about my family, my uncle Rudy Lombard, who moved with CORE and all of these spaces when we're talking about sit-ins and just the beauty of New Orleans and what that means for being a hub. And that's what New Orleans truly is too. So it's something when I think about this aspect of what it means to build community from this space of love, this kind of love that he would speak about. Wasn't this whimsical kind of love, right? But it was this transformative, yeah, ugly, brutal sometimes type of love, even in this aspect of nonviolence, right? But it was this brutality that still kind of came with it, because it forced us to be brave in the face of. So I'm grateful to have those examples. I'm grateful just to be a part of that legacy of artists and activists and social nonconformists, that group that he would speak of so often to, you know, bring messages of light and love and peace forward.
The actions of the New Orleans chapter of the Congress of Racial Equity, also known as CORE, were courageous and fundamental to the progress of the United States civil rights movement from 1960 onward. Along with the Consumers League and the local chapter of the NAACP, they first boycotted stores that failed to hire or serve blacks along Dryad Street. They moved to sit-ins along Canal Street at Woolworth's and then McCrory's department store in September 1960. They persisted in their sit-ins and picketings for more than 2 years. The late Rudy Lombard once called their group courageous to the bone. They had a certain confidence, he said, because they came out of a culture that was so rich. They knew that everything that was unique about New Orleans could be traced back to the black presence.
Yeah, you know, for me, it was one of the things that I dreamed about. And I grew up out in the rural countryside, and most people can tell I'm a country boy. You know, but my parents were sharecroppers. And, you know, they grew up in that system. In fact, my grandfather was born in 1850. He was freed when he was 16 years old.
Wow.
In Mer Rouge, Louisiana. So, you know, I grew up in that system, and hey, we had to mule the whole nine yards when I was growing up as a kid. So I learned very much so firsthand what the struggle to be free was all about. As a matter of fact, when I was a young child, we still had people that would come and knock on our back door in the middle of the night, and they had just left the plantation. Because you could not really get out of the debt that they were going to put you in and do things like that. So, you know, having seen that, witnessed it, and learned it, and having heard my parents talk about Dr. King and the things that were going on, especially out in the rural countryside, it really animated my thought process around dreaming.
For three measly dollars a day, going home and being too tired to cook what little we did have. Because we have been hungry. We have been taught to have dignity and respect. And you know, if we are going through being bit by dogs, some of them being shot down, some of them being beat in jail, we're not fighting back, but we're going on because there's nothing right here. What other nation have gone through what we've gone through? You've never heard of no other race but a Negro that marched through a mob crew just to go to school. James Merritt done. Why? We work all time and never have enough food. I said, but the white man be riding around in fine cars. I said, and they have plenty to eat. But I didn't realize at the time he was stealing it from me. Only way you can really tell how we feel is be a Negro yourself. And I have only just a minute. Only 60 seconds in it. I didn't choose it, but I must suffer if I abuse it. Just a tiny minute, but eternity is in it.
Certainly we know every movement, right, was led by young folk. So really, this goes back again to what we, I think, spoke about from the beginning, this aspect of honoring ancestors, past, present, and future. So what that means to see ourselves, what that means for all of us, truly, to hold our youth in a way that allows them to feel safe with us, that allows them to feel love from us, right? But what I know for certain is that our imagination is our greatest tool when it comes down to our survival, when it comes down to our thriving, when it comes down to how we will excel and expand. So we have to make sure that spaces are being created, right, for our youth to be able to put all of themselves out, to feel like they can truly be their authentic selves, but also to have the space to explore what that really means as well, right? So this is the everyday part of it. It's just really first the waking up to a thing, right? The feeling like I have some stock and I have a stake in my own future, that I can dream my dreams, I can think my thoughts, and they can be my thoughts, they can be my dreams. It doesn't have to be rooted in someone else's vision for me. So I'm just, what you said, forwarding this thing and affording them the opportunity, right, to be more of who they are to become. So that's, again, just the everyday thing of waking up, the everyday thing of finding joy in the midst of, the everyday thing of feeling that you can contribute all of what you have to your community. This aspect of building, I don't care if it's just picking up a piece of paper in front of the house. All of these things help to build community. You know, atom by atom, brick by brick, you know, all of these kind of things. It takes small steps, right? But it really does start with asking a real question of what really do I want and how do I see the world? And not just how do I see the world, but then also how do I see myself moving in the world? And then what is the world that I want to see? So again, this is fostering this aspect of dreaming. This is fostering this aspect of imagination. This is fostering this aspect of how do we bring culture forward in a way that truly allows us to be our big selves. So we have to foster this thing in our children so that they can feel. We need to be able to feel that we really do have a say in how this world can be, capital B, capital E, you know, and how we can show up. They would say, there's no road to freedom. Freedom is the way. So this is about making sure that we are moving free, not just on a Sunday, but we are moving free, we are being free, we are feeling free, and then exploring what that means. So creating spaces.
The 1960s civil rights movement grew from the Southern states' fight to end segregation and Jim Crow laws. Jim Crow laws were state and local laws that enforced segregation in public spaces. Martin Luther King Jr., in partnership with Southern activists, fought for equal access to schools, businesses, and public facilities. As part of his organizing efforts, Dr. King created the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, also known as SCLC, at the New Zion Baptist Church, located at the corner of 3rd and LaSalle Street. SCLC was just one of several organizations in New Orleans who would organize boycotts and sit-ins to force authorities to change Jim Crow laws. In 1960, the Consumers League of Greater New Orleans, an organization fighting racial hiring discrimination, sponsored a boycott of the Dryad Street corridor during the Easter shopping rush. Their goal was to bring attention to the businesses on the Dryad's corridor's refusal to hire black workers, even though the majority of their customers were African American. Many of the participants in the 1960 Dryad's Easter boycott were college students from local universities, such as Jerome Smith from Southern University, Rudy Lombard and Joyce Taylor of Xavier, Aretha Castle and Doris Castle. These students went on to create CORE, the Congress for Racial Equality, and to continue the fight for civil rights and organize their own successful protests.
As they say, I am somebody. Mm-hmm. To have the confidence that when you're having a hard time, when you didn't find the job that you wanted to find and all of those things like that, that you have to do it again tomorrow. So it's good to stay humble within yourself, but at the same time, to create the confidence to know that you have a place in the world.
Absolutely.
And that you can bring some goodness into the world. And from your own vision and viewpoint, from as many different angles and ways and platforms, as kids say it nowadays, to be able to make those things happen. For not just for you, but for everyone around you and pushing it forward, just what Sunny was talking about. The people who took the hard hits for us, many, many years ago, for us to understand that we're walking on the shoulders of giants, and they're in our neighborhood.
You
can look right in their eyes and say good morning.
That's
you can say hello and let those people know that you love them and you understand that in that way because they really did it for us. Use those old concepts to help people still create those things. And when you're looking at young people and thinking about how can I help them have some wealth capital in who they are.
Absolutely.
How they can be vested in and what they want to be and to do things that will really keep that moving forward, that can help them fully develop and be self-actualized.
Yes.
Because that's what's going to help us all collectively be able to move forward.
Yeah. My big daddy was a builder, y'all. The little wooden house that he constructed by hand on Houston Street in Alexandria, Louisiana. The same home that held the memories of 7 children, tens of grands and great-grands, and over 60 years of marriage in the wrinkled hands of its graying walls still stands tall. Mama Dear was a builder, y'all. The way she turned flour and water into wine-like miracles that fed a village called the Sonia Quarters is a huge part of the reason why that neighborhood, too, still stands. You know, builders are those who construct things by putting them together over time. They are artisans. And my great-grandparents, they were artisans. They knew the importance of building strong things. They understood the importance of materials, that what you use to build a thing with or build a thing on determines how long that thing will stand. They knew the importance of technique and skill, knew that practice only makes perfect and that each day is just an apprenticeship. They knew the importance of time, knew that as you build a thing, sometimes you must allow it to settle into the ground, just as you do seeds. They even knew the pain of having to plant some of their own children, grandchildren, and even great-grandchildren 6 feet into the soil. They certainly knew toil, but they were also blessed enough to see some of the harvest. My big daddy and Mama Dear, they came from a long line of builders. They came from a line of men and women who knew how to clear land and lay solid foundations. Had a blueprint already etched into their DNA and into the palms of their hands. They were a people who knew how to pray, knew how to put both hands together, knew that they couldn't do anything alone, that no one can build a lasting thing alone. They knew that someone must come along and draw up the draft. Then someone comes afterwards and has to clear the path. Mama Dear and my big daddy, they believed in a hard day's work,
Believed that the reward of legacy was greater than sore backs and scraped knuckles. Believed that no building that will withstand time was ever built overnight. Believed that it was best to take your time and do it right than to have to start over from scratch or patch up a poor job. Yes, they believed it was better to be poor than to rob. My big daddy and mama dear, they were builders, and they were some of the richest people I've ever known, abundant in some of the most beautiful ways, and everything they ever put their hands to build still continues to stand tall till this day. Brick by brick, we built it, and everything we built is still standing. Brick by brick, we built it, and everything we built is still standing.